Hello?
Michael. Michael. It's Waste the Potential Podcast.
Hi, Mom.
You never call anymore. Why you never call? I call you all the time, you don't answer. Well, you don't have good time for your friends. You get all big hot shot up in the Washington area. You think you're better than us?
Mr. Kim, you should go. This is gonna take a minute.
Listen. I have put up with your shit for too long. Get your ass on the Waste of Potential Podcast for the greatest podcast of all time.
Yeah, sure.
Well, you don't have time to talk to your mother. Michael, if you hang up on me, I swear to God, I'm going to beat you with an element. Either 1 through 5, I don't know which one yet.
Goodbye, Mr. Dallas.
Yeah, he's ready.
We're ready. We're ready.
Yeah,
we're recording, and I'm ready. And I'm nerdy, and I'm ready.
All right, shut the fuck up.
Okay, here, shut the fuck up.
Welcome, everyone, to another episode of the Wasted Potential Podcast, Glass Half Full. This week, we have a special guest star. Shaggy canceled on us, so we had to get Mike.
Shaggy!
Mike, professional podcaster, lover extraordinaire, introduce yourself.
I'm glad to be here. This is actually my second time on Wasted Potential, and I'm looking forward to talking about one of the best movies ever made, The Fifth Element.
Every 5,000 years.
Remove the shield.
When the three planets are in eclipse, the black hole, like a door, is open. Evil comes, spreading terror and chaos.
There's nothing that can stop this.
There is only one thing.
Perfect.
The Mondo G1 have in their possession the only weapon to defeat evil. Four elements gathered around a fifth.
Major Dallas, selected for a mission of the utmost importance.
What mission?
Save the world.
Don't move.
Hey, Shane, what was the last movie? Oh, I'm here. Hi, I'm Ronnie. I'm here too. What was the last movie that Mike was with us for a podcast? What was it?
We did Arachnophobia.
Hey! Shane's ready to go.
I'm sharp.
We're hitting on all cylinders right now.
Well, I'm glad you called me. No room for amateurs in this game.
All right. Woo. So Mike said it. This week we watched The Fifth Fucking Element. How does one solve a problem like The Fifth Element? What is this movie, Mike?
Well, I feel like you know a lot more about the background behind it. Going into how do you solve The Fifth Element, I like that question a lot. I'm actually very interested to deep dive a little bit into The Fifth Element, because I actually don't know a lot about trivia. So looking forward to that portion of it. But The Fifth Element, going to the synopsis zone that I am, you know, I do on our other podcast, Working Title.
hey, stick in your lane. Stay in your lane.
You're going off script.
On a base level, The Fifth Element is the quintessential movie of the 90s. It has everything that you would want from the action, adventure, sci-fi, fantasy, sexuality that is the epitome of good movies with no bars hold, no reservations. Definitely nobody was embarrassed by the making of it, and it just came out perfectly. On a deeper note, as far as the story goes, it is a future movie hundreds of years into the current reality that we live in, where aliens have now made contact and blah blah blah. We've had a lot of that kind of build up that doesn't get explained, but we are in this believable future where there is it's not dystopian, but it definitely is how you would imagine the world to progress toward a populated Earth with action, adventure, and love and romance, and it's just, I mean, all around just good. I mean, if you just ask what's the fifth element's about, it's about being a good movie.
That's a good way to put it. I think it won an Oscar for...
Oh, it's very far from Oscars.
The year. It actually did... I think it was nominated for one. I don't think it won.
Well, Betterman soundtrack, because the soundtrack is phenomenal. I feel like I'm getting ahead of myself. I already want to talk about how good this goddamn movie is.
Okay. So, in our glass half full usual approach here, we usually just ask our guest, Mike, a couple questions here, and that's why I'm here. I shouldn't be here right now, but Shane didn't want a podcast alone. He's afraid.
I don't want to be alone.
So I'm here to run the interview while Mike talks about his favorite movie. I question him, and Shane...
You're like the podcast moderator. Am I getting there right?
Yeah, sure, because maybe it'll be a fight. I hope it's a fight. Okay, so, Mike, tell us, when did you first see this film, The Fifth Element?
When it came out, back in 1997. Yep. The year that it was released. That's the first time I saw it. I was a little boy of 8 years old, and it just blew my mind.
I could see how Mila Jovovich would get imprinted into the 80s.
Believe it or not, it was Bruce Willis.
What a hunk.
The hairline.
Corbin Dallas, which would bring me to, let me find it, my first little trivia. So when they originally wrote this, Corbin Dallas, I can't figure out how they changed the original character's name, but his original name was supposed to be Zoltman Blaros.
Well, it was written by a Frenchman, so that's not surprising.
Oh, this movie is the most French sci-fi movie ever to be made.
Are you a big fan of Luc Besson?
You know, I didn't even know who the hell he was, even when I was such a fanboy of The Fifth Element, until he came out with Valerian, and I was so excited to see his newest, you know, almost two-decade later film, and now I know who he is, and I kind of don't like him anymore.
Well, welcome to the journey I took, Mike.
So, my first time seeing this film... I think it was in college. I think it was probably you, Shane, said, did you see The Element? I'm like, no. So I'm like, okay, it's fine. I saw like a year ago and thought, oh, this is kind of a wacky movie. Today, as Shane was telling me about behind-the-scenes stuff, I was like, I don't think I care for this movie anymore either. But there's a lot of fun things that make that just stand out to me in about this movie. So that's why I don't really think I like it, but I do enjoy the weird journey it takes you on. What about you, Shane, the first time you saw this movie?
I think my dad owned it on DVD, so I was pretty young, probably around 8 years old, and I remember it being like one of those scenes where like my parents would be like, you know, oh, put your hands up, because they already know where the tits are coming in the movie or something, but you sometimes you don't know that there's boobs on screen, and I could see them, so this movie was really imprinted on me as well.
Anything about the plot that imprinted?
I love future Die Hard in space. This is awesome.
Just the tips. You're going to get 2 minutes in here in the conversation going, hey, when I was a child, I saw tits really young.
Shit, it's Carrie Hutchins. She had the biggest tits I've ever seen, I think. I got to catch a glimpse of these warlocks. Let's make a move.
This plot is bonkers, and if you scratch at it a little bit, it starts to peel really quick, and you go, no, and you try to push it back up. So it's best not to even think about what's going on. Just watch what's on the screen, and it is an amazing assortment of goofy action sci-fi comedy.
I would agree. Yeah, there's like, definitely comedy elements to it, and I think it's intentional for sure.
Yeah.
Or unintentional.
Well, I think it makes sense once they kind of like describe the team that came together to make it. So Luc Besson grew up reading comic books that were famous in France. I guess France is like super into comic books.
Nerd.
And the two most famous ones are Jean Mobius Chéreau and Jean-Claude Mézier, I want to say. That's his.
Sure.
But they're two like very famous. They made like heavy metal. They wrote Valerian.
Really? These are the guys behind heavy metal. Wow.
Yeah. And then I think they also helped with The Watchmen.
Okay, I can see that.
But don't quote me on that. But yeah, very, very French famous comic makers. So he met up with them and basically told them, like, create this world. And literally what they drew is what this movie is. So it's this weird, like, sci-fi comic book people, which makes more sense why it's so wacky. But, yeah. So,
does it explain why it's like Looney Tunes?
Because it's French, Ronnie.
Okay. Comic book plus French equals Looney
equals
Tunes.
Looney Tunes. Okay. But, so some interesting things about this. So Luc Besson, the director, he obviously made Valerian City of 1,000 Planets, whatever that means.
Yeah. I thought it was Valerian the Lost City of Steel.
That didn't take off too well. He made Lucy with Scarlett Johansson.
Oh, God, he made that one too?
Taken 2.
He's not got a good batting record.
Well, so he had some early hits, and then he went
back. Oh, I see. So it's one of those situations where the retirement should have come early.
Oh, yeah. But at like 30.
Yeah, because I'm looking at this list. Yeah. Okay, so obviously the big one is Leon the Professional. Okay. I've never seen it, but it's like Shane's favorite movie.
That's great. Yeah.
Of all time.
Another Frenchman in there, a lead French.
Let's talk business. This guy comes to town every Tuesday. Are you free Tuesday?
Yeah, I'm free Tuesday.
You can't stop what you can't see.
This guy came from the outside. He was a pro. He was fast.
In the art of the kill, Leon was the master.
Le croissant?
No, monsieur.
Oh, you got this coffee?
Yep, Jean Renault.
Yeah, Nikita is also kind of a famous French film.
Yeah, Femme Nikita. Colombiana, that movie sucked. From
Paris. Why shame? Why is it so terrible?
From Paris with Love.
It's because it starts a woman.
He made Taken, The Transporter, Kiss of the Dragon. That
now, you said he did Taken. Did he do the first one?
Yeah, he did the first and the second.
But not the third. Couldn't get him
he
back.
He just couldn't get him back. He had bigger things to do, like Valerian.
The Valerian. And then,
he had way too much CGI to work with.
Oh, my God. Dude, he has a quote where they're like, oh, how is this baking Valerian compared to the Fifth Element? And he goes, the Fifth Element was a nightmare.
It was a nightmare to do the Fifth Element. The special effect was from another age. And I have to lock my camera for 8 hours and I couldn't come in the set. And it was really painful, in fact, for me. It's funny because Fifth Element has 188 shots with special effect. Valerian has 2,700, so it's 20 times, you know, bigger. No, I was always bored, not bored, but worried about the real alien. In Fifth Element, I have a couple of them, and I always see the guy in it, so it's complicated. Here on Valerian, I have an actor playing an alien, so he's in gray suit with dots. But the way he's playing, the way he interprets the thing is very there. It's human. I can see it. And I can see if it's good.
I may have gone too far in a few places.
He's like, with Valerian, it's just computers. I don't have to do anything.
You know what's funny about that? And this is a great transition right there. One of the best things about The Fifth Element, one of the things I think is one of the that makes it kind of a good movie, is the fact that it has practical effects throughout the entirety of it. Like, there's CGI in it, and it's bad CGI. It's the 90s. But the practical effects in that movie, and I gotta admit that I'm a little bit biased. I really love practical effects, but just so good. Like, I love the obvious alien, you're wearing this little plasticky looking mask and everything is so well done. But if you really pay attention to The Fifth Element, and I hope you guys would, are we allowed to talk about watching movies under the influence on this podcast? Okay, so if you watch The Fifth Element, like, really stoned, you start to pick up on the subtleties in the background. You see that the set design, the intention, like, there's in one of the scenes at the very beginning of the movie where the spaceship crashes being attacked by these pig-looking men into this, you know, moon or whatever.
You can't just go along with what people are saying, Susan, okay? There's no scientific proof, no real evidence of a man-bear pig.
They collect the remains of the one survivor, which ends up becoming the Lilu, who is the female character in this film, who is the Fifth Element. you can see on the box in so not explaining this correctly, the survivor in the crash is just a hand, right? They just need a couple of cells to bring that person back. Like, the technology is able to resurrect this person through just the cells in this hand. But this...
I see no problems with that.
No. It's fine. It's fine. You got to gloss over it. Like Shane said, you just got to... It's a suspension of disbelief, right? So you're just along for a good time. That's what this movie is. You strap in, you're going to have fun. Yeah. So this hand that they bring in as the sole survivor of this crash is gripping a looks like a door knocker, and if you pay attention to the film, the bad guy in the film, who is Jean Baptiste Emmanuel Zorg, who's played by Gary Oldman, one of the best actors out there, he has the case brought to him because he's working for this monster deity that is trying to destroy all life, but in his pure evil, right? And so he's collecting these things, because he's all about money. He's an entrepreneur. He's a businessman. And this monster demon deity has been contacting Zorg, who's this... He's a human, but he's a bad guy. But he collects these stones.
There is the stone.
Which are... the catalyst of this whole film. I guess I didn't... I should have really gone into the whole synopsis of this. But he gets this... I'm way off track. So he gets this case, and on the case, you can see that there's two handles on it, and one of the handles is missing. In other words, Lilu, the sole survivor, the hand, is gripping that piece of the case. So in other words, there's a lot of detail and thought that's actually put into each shot and each scene in this. So as much as I want to shit on him for Valerian, he actually was good at least at some point in his career of making an actually in-depth, thought out, and beautiful movie. It just really is sad to see that he lost that.
Yeah. Well, with I guess The Fifth Element, he wrote it when he was 16.
No way.
And then carried it through life, could not get it made. He met the two comic book guys who made it, wanted to do the concept with him, so they drew it up. And it wasn't until Leon the Professional was such a big hit that a studio would take a chance on this, because everyone would read it and they'd be like, what the fuck is this?
I'm actually glad that happened, because I do not want to watch The Fifth Element written by a 16-year-old.
Yeah, probably not best. A lot more boobs in that one.
Okay, so... You said the practical effects. Going back to kind of like that conversation from there, I like in the very beginning, because this is my biggest complaint, is I don't understand this fucking movie. So at the very beginning, like, I love that, like, it's the practical effects mixed with like the special effects CGI kind of stuff. And I love how subtle and slow and reminiscent of like 2001 Space Odyssey is. And in the next scene, someone's screaming on the radio about you, like, singing a song. It's Chris Tucker. Just screaming, I'm like, I just don't get how these two fucking movies are the same. And you go from like the awesome, practical, like goofy characters that are like armadillos. That I guess we didn't get to the whole plot of this. It starts with the armadillos in the desert.
We didn't do any of the plot, but I'm actually trying to resist doing the plot, because I would love to go through it all and do it proper justice. But I, you know what, I'm kind of jaded that I'm the synopsis guy, so...
Oh, okay. So here's what we'll do. I'll synopsis it, and you're our subject matter expert. So you can object at any point. Okay.
I'm just going to go.
So in the beginning, there was Luke Perry, and Luke Perry fucks everything up. So the key is handed off. These armadillos came down to get the stones in the Fifth Element because they said evil's coming and it's not safe on Earth.
That's fair.
Shit goes wrong. They go forward 300 years. Now a giant ball of evil is heading for Earth. They listen to the priest who says the Fifth Element's going to kill it all and we got to let these people in. Armadillos come in. They get ambushed by bulldogs. All right,
interjection.
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up!
You're missing key plots here. So the priest is not just a priest. So there's a... What happens is the ball shows up 300 years in the future, like you just barely said. And there is now this... Mm-hmm. I don't know. It's almost like... it is the president's war room where on Earth, and they have brought in, which I think is a really interesting fact, that they include in this war room members of multiple religions. You can see them. There's these old men sitting in front of this council of like governmental looking people, and each one has like some kind of robe or vestments of a different religion, right? So in other words, they include in this futuristic version of reality and world the opinions and the expertise of these different peoples and different sects. In other words, we're living in a world that is all-inclusive now. So this is important to the fact that this is a good movie, at least as far as the way I see it is. It is move past bias, but it also makes people be involved. But the president definitely feels like these are the kooks of their religions. What the fuck are you talking about? We're keeping you here because we're just trying to make sure you guys don't riot in our fucking streets. So, Cornelius, he is the passed down version of the religion that has to do with the armadillo people, as you refer to them, right? So, the armadillo people came down and they said, we got to get the Wanachiwin. And so they come down and they've been storing this weapon in Egypt in a pyramid. And that was the Luke Perry scene where we have this archaeologist, he's there trying to figure out this hieroglyphics, and we're introduced to the whole, you know, backstory about the whole thing. So this is an engineered thing of these Wanachiwans left on Earth to defend the universe against evil, right? Like, I know this is a bad movie, but it's so pure, right? You know what I mean?
Thank you.
It is pure.
I can finally breathe now. Okay, I can finally breathe now. I'm just like, Jesus Christ.
No, it's good. Like, it is purely good. Anyway, so they keep this weapon on Earth, and this sect of this religion, they're the ones who are, you know, they've been given the task of defending and taking care of this temple that will then eventually at some point be used to stop again. And this is, they refer to the fact that this has happened multiple times throughout the history of the universe, and it just needs to, they're the next ones in line to then stop it again. Mm. So anyways, so we're like now caught back evil, up to where you were. And we've only been 15 minutes into the movie now, by the way.
Yeah,
of course. So it's like the evil space embodiment orb thing, like, get strong again every 300 years, or is it just like this one time?
Nope, it's a recycling thing, right? Like there's a lot of depth there, right? Like, it's the universe, right? If you talk about how we function as far as the Big Bang, right, there's theories out there that is a reoccurring event that explodes, implodes, and this is kind of hits on that fact that this is something that needs to be continued on forever, no matter what. This is not the final moment of it. This is just the most recent version of it. So it's that little story of history of the defense of reality against pure evil. There's a very beautiful version of looking at the fact that it's important to do this, but it also is unimportant for the grand scheme of what we are.
Shane, talk about how the director is a fucking pedophile.
Oh no. Did that happen?
He's not a pedophile. Stop, we're gonna get sued. He's not a pedophile. He just may... There's some implication with Mila.
Oh, no.
And this may be created by myself. But, Mike, do you know how old Mila Jovovich is in this movie?
I believe that she was 26.
She's 19 years old. Would you like to know how old Bruce Willis was?
42.
Yeah, 41. Very good, yeah.
I did know he was
Luke
older.
Yeah, Luke Besson is 19 either.
Hey, 19's legal.
License and registration, please.
What seems to be the officer problem?
Yeah, so the story goes with Mila that Luke Besson interviewed 5,000 actresses,
wow,
to include Mila. Never called back. She bumped at him at the Chateau Marmont.
Marmont?
In Marmont in L.A., some famous-ass hotel, and she bumped into him, and she said that was the first time he got to see her without makeup, and he was taken aback and wanted her to audition.
So what I'm taking away from that, he likes beauty from an unbiased point, right?
Like, yeah, that's what I get to.
He did call her perfect. She's
unfortunately,
perfect
he also... So the language that Mila speaks... is made up by Luc Besson. He wrote a language with over 300 characters.
He Tolkien'd it.
And he made 19-year-old Mila memorize the entire language and would quiz her every day and would sometimes make her talk in the conversation all day.
Of course, like all kids, I had imaginary friends, but not just one. I had hundreds and hundreds, and all of them from different backgrounds who spoke different languages. And one of them, his name was Caleb, he spoke a magical language that only I could understand.
Patato? In this made-up language.
Okay, well, you're not, like, making me feel any surprise here, because here's the thing. Like, there are so many stories of crazy fucking directors and producers who have done stranger things than that. Woody Allen, I mean.
True. All right.
I love that Mike is so here to defend this movie. So
he'll die.
I know what I signed up for.
This is a good movie to die on the hill. Yeah.
I will be more respectful. So then, you mentioned the practical effects. Give me something else that you love about this film here.
I really think that they did a fantastic job on the scores and the transitions between the music and the costume design. There is a very French element to it. I mean, Corbin Dallas has a opened back orange shirt throughout it. Like, it's just a progressive as far as what I would say the 90s would have been at the time. I mean, it is 97, but still, seeing that this just, the music was ahead of its time. I mean, it's not even really ahead of its time. It even is still strange now in 2023, but it definitely has this flow to it. And even you guys mentioned at the beginning, is this a comedy? I think 100% it is a comedy, but it's intentionally a comedy. Chris Tucker's performance is his best performance in any fucking film I've ever seen him in before.
Here he is, the one and only winner of the Gemini Crockett contest. This boy is fueled like fire. So start melting, ladies, because the boy is hotter than hot. He's hot, hot, hot. The right size, right build, right head, right on. To those 50 billion pair of ears out there. Pop it, D-Man. Unbelievable. Wither, ladies, wither. He's going to set the world on fire. Right here from 5 to 7, you'll know everything there is to know about that D-Man. And what are you looking at? Intimate Snow Muffin's middle name. Don't tell me, my man. You've never seen the circus? Please, oh, please, my titties, because Herb's in the place and he's on the case. Yesterday's frog will be tomorrow's friend. A hotel of 1,001 follies, lollies, and little lollies. A magic fountain full of non-stop wine, women, and
I don't know, Morty. Maybe I hate all myself. Maybe I think I deserve to die. I don't know.
So we encapsulate. We have that. We have the drama, we have the love, we have the... I mean, I'm in many topics of what I like about this film. I'm not answering just one right now.
I think I agree with
it's you got where... the It's got those comedic elements. It's got those the rememberable scenes. It has the quotable... I mean, I quote it all the time. Like, you know, it just hits on every level.
Gary Oldman.
It's got Gary Oldman. I mean, that alone is a positive to a film, is that Gary Oldman's in it.
My favorite.
Yeah, I mean, he's playing the same character he did in Leon the Professional, just kind of a crazy guy. But I guess him and Luke are like friends. And basically, Gary Oldman was doing Zorg in a way that would make it hard for the director not to laugh. So this character is supposed to just try to get you to laugh at him.
I'm even resisting trying to quote this movie right now. That's how ingrained it is in my head. Just you saying that brought forth a ton of stuff I wanted to just say of Gary Oldman's quotes during this film, right?
My favorite.
And, you know, I was thinking about it, and as far as, like, the story actually goes, if you actually break this film down to what it is base and you don't actually watch the film itself, it does not take place over a long period of time. It is very compressed, regardless of the intro of the first 10 minutes, then 300-year jump. I'm saying as far as the main plot goes, it takes the course of 2 days or 3 days. It's not very like long, but it is, and it also is only filmed in a little bit of small locations, right? We start in New York City. We're in Corbin Dallas' apartment when we first switch over to it. We see a little bit of Zorg industry, so that's still in New York City, and then we have a little bit of the priest apartment scenes, and then we go straight to an airport, and we have some airport scenes, and then we jump to a cruise ship, and that's it. Like, it is actually a very compressed film. It's a very short story, but it's well done in the sense of it's a two-hour film. So a lot of films, they take a very long story, and they stretch it over the course of all of these events and this time and all this these locations, but they have to, like, cut it so much, and it's so, like, it can become a little bit more convoluted, where this really sticks to the fact that it is compressed. It's a small story, and they purposefully did it in the sense that it is a minuscule portion of what is important in the grand scheme of the universe and time, but it's just good to see this little, like, quick story that just has these feelings and these emotions that just well done in the sense of, you know, after you're at the end, you just feel like you saw almost like a short story done well.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like it's like, for lack of
it's not drawn out or dragged out.
Yes, it's not like a pretentious, like, space movie. It's not like 2001, like, Space Odyssey or, like, Andromeda Strain, where it's kind of like doing that. That's why it doesn't really feel like a normal sci-fi. It feels to me more like a sci-fi, like, more like fantasy, where it's kind of like almost like a fairy tale, where it's very just like, this is all really silly and doesn't have, like, Shane and I were talking about this, we're rewatching it right now, was like, I understand what's going on in the scene, so it's not, like, that complicated, but I think the whimsical, like, silly goofiness is what kind of...
Oh, it's a charm.
Makes it memorable to me, as opposed to, like, there's so many, like, trashy, like, 80s and 90s sci-fi films that are kind of like this, and, like, the lieu of, like, Star Wars and whatnot. Sure. So, like, and, like, but this one feels like a director had a vision. I don't fucking get that vision, but I know, like, this is, like, a Luc Besson film. Like, and it capitals, like, that goofy silliness I've seen in some other of his movies, too, or it's just, like...
It doesn't take itself too serious.
No, and that's why it's so memorable. It's all about what's happening in this scene here and the silliness, what's going on. The tone is so everywhere, but it doesn't really matter because it's like, this scene is what matters. Yes. This moment is what matters. It's very...
And it's so overacted. Each scene is overacted in a good 90s way, right? Like, anybody who is born after the 2000s would look at this and be like, this is the cheesiest goddamn shit I've ever seen, and not appreciate the subtleties of the 80s and the 90s.
It is definitely a product of its time and the people that came together on it.
Now, I gotta say one thing about where we've talked about Luke a lot, and we've talked about how he's a shitty person in reality. I kind of feel there needs to be a...
Well, he may not be. This is all conjecture for me.
Oh, I see. So I have zero research in this type of stuff. So the type of... I don't like to deep dive into people because everybody's going to be bad at their core. That's unfortunate. It's just humanity. But the fact is, if you don't know who these people are, you would probably consider this to be a better movie.
Oh, no. Yeah. He did a good job. And it feels... It's the most authentic sci-fi I think I've ever seen. Where it's just like, no, this is what we think the future is, and fuck you.
but I also think, like, that's kind of that tone lets them get away with this. Okay, for example, so Shane tells me, like, I saw this movie, like, a year ago. I enjoyed it. And today Shane's putting it under the lens of, this director's a scumbag. So the entire movie is just Mila Jovovich.
It's okay. It's okay. She's
Jehovah's Witness. Mila Jehovah's Witness. Like, just her basically naked. So it's like, I feel uncomfortable. So you have to separate whether those are true conjectures or most likely not. Like, the person from the art, I guess.
No, I mean, okay, so I can go into that.
It's also hard, too.
There is a version of sexuality in this movie, right? And if you don't think about it in the way that you're trying to be creepy, then you don't... I mean, it's a misappropriation of what... sexuality in a film is, right? Like, we don't have established derogatives within a film, right? This is like you said, it's a fantasy. It's a fantasy film, right? We're not supposed to be watching something and then relating it to the reality of who these people are. No, we're watching a story. We're watching somebody who is not being sexualized in the way of inappropriateness. We're watching, like, it's like reading a book, okay? Like, if we're reading a character, and we are only existing this character within this world, there's nothing inappropriate about that. It is purely, at its core, a story. And if you are trying to make it something more than that, and you're trying to bring in reality into that, of course you're going to ruin that. You can ruin it in any way easily by bringing in the fact that these are real people really existing in the world. But if you step back and you put yourself in the world of fantasy, which is what the film industry is doing, and you put yourself purely in the state of watching this story play out, there is nothing wrong with seeing the sexualization of human beings within this world, because you're seeing the development of a relationship and love. And of course, you don't want to see the evilness that can be portrayed within a story of the derogatory sense of bad sexualization. But in this film, that does not happen. There is purely showed of the appreciation of a woman's body. She's referred to as perfect and as the element itself. And we look at the fact that even the characters within the film, they try to be respectful when she doesn't understand the normalities of what it means to be a human in New York, where she takes her clothes off to strain them out. She wasn't doing that to show her boobs. She was doing that because she doesn't understand that she is being considered as a sexual object. And her character ends up playing of the fact that she's talking to Corbin and trying to convince him that it is not just about being a perfect woman, is the fact that her innocence is what makes Corbin attracted to her. The fact that he came out of a relationship with a woman that destroyed his heart, there's quips about it, and he falls in love with her because he's looking for this perfect woman. That's a quote that he said at the very beginning of the film when he's driving his cab around and his friend finger calls, and he says, I don't want all the women, I just want a perfect woman. And that sense of what he wants is the unbiased, influenced version of just strength, determination, love. That's what he wanted from that character, and she had all of that in it. So if you get rid of the fact that she was 19 and probably got horribly treated in the entire industry, then we can actually see something that is actually really well written.
Life isn't about sex. Life is about children and passion.
Yeah.
And spirit. It's not about fucking in balls and pussy. It's about love. It's about people. It's about connection. But it's not about tossing salad. It's not about cock and ass and tits and butthole pleasures. It's not about his rusty trombone and his dirty Sanchez. It's about love.
And you shouldn't feel like you shouldn't feel like you're now seeing something disturbing.
Yeah. I agree. You went in deep on that, Mike. I appreciate it. Ronnie, what's the next question?
Oh my god. This is so funny.
When you bring up the love and the special effects, those guys work.
The love and the special effects. I love those two connections right there.
the special effects team. Jesus. So it was done by a company called Digital Domain. And to just show how much the animatronics people put in and freaking just the New York team.
Oh, I believe it.
So they built a 70 by 22 foot set. So the buildings you're seeing are 22 feet. Yeah. And they painted them all and sculpted them.
They did. They put their time in.
Yeah. It took 60 people working 6 days a week, 9 months to construct that set. For 13 minutes of the film. So that's why I think the story too is very concise, because I think this was made on a budget of like $60 million. So like, they were like, okay, we have two set pieces. Everything else has to be in someone's apartment. Like, that's all we could do. And they did it well. They put everything they had into it.
Yeah, and that's kind of going back to what I was saying. There's really not a lot of actual sets if you break it down. In fact, I just noticed that for the first time. I was watching this film last night, actually, to catch up a little bit, remind myself. For the 110th time I've seen this. But yeah, I mean, I kind of realized it's not a big spectrum as far as where they go, and there's not a lot of sets involved.
Ronnie, what's another question you have?
Okay. Can we go back to, you're going through the synopsis. It's going to the point where someone falls into his, oh yeah, the science thing. This is part that confused me now. I legitimately just don't understand this. So, you mentioned it before, right, with the hand, the briefcase, they're going to change her DNA and resculpt her. So basically, I was confused on this, and I've never understood this. So they are taking her DNA, but why do they make her human and not her true form?
What do you mean by that?
So like, the fifth element, right, the other elements are
Oh yeah, wouldn't she be an armadillo man?
Yeah, she'd be an would she be an armadillo man, like her true form, or is she like one of those?
Yeah, why did
energy?
She come?
No. No, okay, I would love to get into this. So that is explained in the film, and it's not a subtlety, by the way. You should really feel ashamed that you missed this. The doctor, so when they're bringing in the general, right, and they're bringing in the military, there's that scientist, the really creepy guy with the jizz on his face during the black light. You know that guy?
Oh,
so
yeah.
He explains it. He says, all right, General, this is normal human DNA. You, me, and blah, blah, blah. And he goes through the whole thing. And this is this person's DNA. And it's this construct. It is exactly the same as ours, but more intricate, more detailed, almost like it's been engineered, right? He goes through that whole spiel. In other words, this weapon is being kept on Earth for a reason, because it was engineered from human DNA. It was used human DNA, engineered to create a person who is a human being at its core. It shares the same DNA as us. It's not a Wanda Chiwan. It's not an alien. These are almost like the constructs, right? These are the great builders of the weapon. That's what the Wanda Chiwan are. They're not. They didn't use a Wanda Chiwan as their weapon. No, they constructed a person to be used because humans have the ability to share love, and that's the point. The Wanda Chiwan can't share love. The other alien species can't share love.
Love was the fifth element.
Love is the fifth element. That is the whole point of the film.
Oh.
That's what they say at the end there. When Corbin is with her at the end, and she's saying, I need you to say it, before she activates her weapon that destroys evil, that's the fifth element.
It's a trap.
What? You guys not really get the fact that this entire fucking film is the fifth element is referring to the element of love?
No, I...
It's about love.
I know.
No,
love.
I'm just confused. Okay, so I understand that's literally what it's saying. So is she the embodiment of love?
She's a construct, a genetically engineered weapon used of human DNA to be able
love.
To the ability to show the special part of humanity in this whole film is that humans, as all the races that are presented in this film, are the only ones capable of purely having the ability to express love with each other, and the Wanda Chiwan have found that and used it. They engineered it to be able to create a weapon that has concentrated love. Like, okay, we're going into the silliness and the stupidness, but they concentrated
right,
love.
Earth, wind, fire, water, love.
I'm losing you guys.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Yeah.
What did we learn, Palmer?
I don't know, sir.
I don't fucking know either. I guess we learned not to do it again.
Yes, sir.
I'm fucked if I know what we did.
Yes, sir. It's hard to say.
Jesus fucking Christ.
No, I'm here.
Yeah,
listen,
we're here.
Shane is mumbling.
So they just concentrated a human DNA structure to be able to focus love beam out somebody's mouth to stop pure evil. So it wasn't a Wanda Chiwan alien, and when you refer to it as its true form, the true form is she actually is a human. That is what her DNA structure is built of. It's just her DNA structure has been manufactured to create it a human. So it's she's a made human. Through time and space. So that capsule that she came out with at the very beginning, it looked like a sarcophagus, the one that they bring her out of the temple there. That is a storage device. It is like being frozen in carbonite, right? So she is Lilu inside of that little capsule right there. Like, there is a human being inside of that little capsule right there.
Well, goddamn. Take that, Ronnie. Cantankerous bitch.
I don't think you guys know what you signed up for.
This is wonderful. I've never looked at the fifth element quite so deeply in my life.
So why does Gary Oldman help?
shut up. Take it back control of this. So, let's talk about Corbin Dallas. Corbin Dallas is our main character.
I keep asking questions. I love when he goes into tirades.
Corbin Dallas is a former... He's Bruce Willis, but he's a former special forces... And he has a certificate that says Medal of Honor.
I know. And it's thrown up with all of his other career medals.
You did it. He lives in a shitty apartment, and he was a major, I guess, and he's the only survivor of his super elite special forces. Mm-hmm.
The Army doesn't give you any good retirement?
Yeah, apparently future Army doesn't have...
I mean, we don't need to have a suspension of disbelief for that.
No. I feel that one. So he is driving a cab to make ends meet. That is how Lilu, she crashes in, gets there. He kind of gets kicked out of the story because the priest is like, we got to get control of her. We're the only ones to know what to do. Like, they kind of are the ones that plan, but they're kind of impotent and fucking worthless. But Bruce Willis gets kicked out. He thinks she's gone, whatever. And then his former commander is like, I've got a guy just for this. He can come out of retirement. And that's Bruce Willis. So how did the president know about the stones being in the alien?
So at the beginning of the film, when we first have the first appearance of the Orb of Evil, right? We have an incident that occurs where there's a U.S. government warship that's out there trying to figure out what the hell this anomaly is in space. And they send out some probes, don't get much information back. There is an incident where they try to shoot it with some nuclear warheads, and it evil begets evil kind of a thing, where Cornelius is part of this council of priests that are sitting in the war room, right, to give advice. Uh-huh. And
they're war priests.
Right, they don't know what it is. The president doesn't know it. The government doesn't know what it is. And they're... Cornelius, the priest, he raises his hand and he says that this is pure evil, blah, blah, blah. He starts explaining that he knows what it is and that it's part of his ancient books, right? So the incident happens. Mm-hmm. The president kind of blows him off and they lose a warship. And then there's a scene where Cornelius brings out his documentation and his ancient books, and he shows the president of the United States what it was, what his theory is, and that it is very important in order to stop this that they need to collect these four stones, and the Wanachee wouldn't have them. Mm-hmm. And at that very moment, he gets a call saying a Wanachee spaceship is trying to pass into the jurisdiction of the U.S. And so he says, you allow them in with my best regards, blah, blah, blah. So he's now on board. He's essentially what he's doing is they sent... Mm-hmm. Like, the biggest guns they had off this biggest warship they had, and it did nothing to it. So now I think the president is right. Open to any kind of suggestion of what it might be. He jumped on real quick, I gotta admit. It's a little bit of a plot hole. I think the president of the United States should take a little bit more time, and a little bit more so science should have been involved. But yeah, sure. But as far as the film goes, that's
leave
why.
Debo alone, okay? He's got off the block, and now you got the president, okay?
So that's how the government now is involved, right? And so they bring in the general to go out and get their best man on the team, which is Corbin Dallas, to make sure that they... all his job really was just to... Like, he's a cab driver, and he's continued to do a cab driver. That's kind of like the play of it, is that after his big military career, this guy goes, and he's a Medal of Honor winner, and he's driving a fucking cab. And then the government comes back and they say, hey, we need you again, but you're going to be essentially just escorting these four fucking rocks. So he's just fed up with all of this bullshit.
Do you think this movie is like a little bit satirical? Like, do you think like Luc Besson has like that kind of biting sense of humor to kind of go after like kind of the U.S. you know, economy or just how things work or how like the future kind of works? Like, what do you
think? Oh, absolutely. So he is French, right? And so the French have always been, not even a joke. Like, they have always been anti-establishment. They've always been anti-government, right? They've definitely have their protests in their streets, and they do make fun of the fact that the hierarchy is a bunch of morons running what they think is this silly little state. Yeah. So for sure, I think he was playing on the fact that he was trying to make fun of military service. I think he was playing on the fact that people are mistreated within their service, and I think he was definitely playing on the fact that it's supposed to be silly that Ruby Rye, the radio DJ of this whole film, was making fun of what society considers to be important of this whole film. At the end of this, if you really think about how many people are involved in this entire situation that saved the entire planet, there's only like 12 people who actually know it actually happened, and that's funny.
It's kind of funny.
It was weird that when I was like watching this, like I kept getting. Have you ever seen Brazil, the Terry Gilliam film?
I have not.
Okay, so I kept getting flashbacks of that movie, which is like that's a total like satire, and it's kind of making fun of like the whole like British bureaucracy of how slow everything is and pointless it all is. But like I was getting like little flashbacks for like I was getting okay, I could see that sense of humor is there, kind of like that satirical kind of like darker stuff.
Okay.
Kind of going on there for sure. I definitely enjoyed that kind of just like being like that's what I said. Like I don't really get this movie like plot wise, but like I said, it's got a vision, and I think the director has a good sense of humor about how silly it all is, because if the fifth element is love, then you gotta know, well, it's a little gonna be silly.
It's on the nose. The entire thing is on the nose. But I think it's intentionally on the nose. So I hear where you're coming from, and I agree with you. I'm interested though. I'll check out Brazil.
Yeah, it's a good one.
That ends miserably though. Kind of an unusual Ronnie fashion. Yeah. Instead of a fun happy ending, that ends miserably. And now
I'm
sad.
There's nothing wrong with feeling emotions.
Okay, so why does Gary Oldman help Sauron the black hole? I'm confused. Explain, tell us about Zork.
Sure.
I love Zork.
So,
help the eye of Sauron.
Sauron, yeah. It really is. That's a good comparison right there. I think why Zork is involved with this entire situation is, I think evil, Cornelius said at the very beginning, evil begets evil, right? In other words, it's going to latch on to bad vibes. And I think Zork is a bad guy. And he's just the quintessential bad guy. He's just, through his core, just a evil dude. So whatever this entity is that exists in this future world, picked up on the fact that there is this businessman who doesn't give a shit. He'll sell his dying grandmother in order to make a buck, right? That's his kind of business model. And he's the big, Corbin loses his job at some point, right? He gets fired. And he thinks it's because he crashed his cab. But actually, the industry that Zork runs, which is called Zork Industry, actually owns his cab company. And there is a scene where Zork's assistant comes up to him and says, there's a problem with the cab companies. I suggest we fire 500,000 of our employees. And Zork just says, fire 1 million. In other words, he's just fucking people over to fuck people over. And he says that, cab company. So, Corbin Dallas was one of those 1 million employees who just happened to lose his job. So, in other words, Zork is just trying to... He's a capitalist, right? And he's a good capitalist. He owns a weapons company, a weapons manufacturing company. He owns a cab company. He probably owns a tremendous amount of companies. In his office, you can see architecture. You can see artifacts. You can see all this stuff. So, he's just this... tycoon of business, right? And he doesn't care who he kills or who he screws over or what he has to do. He's just bad to his core. So because he has so much influence and power, not only in New York City, but just in general on the planet Earth, this Sauron, ball of flame out in space, is essentially probably telling him, contractually that promising his brain or whatever you want to call it, that he will profit off of this, because it makes a phone call. The ball of flame somehow uses radio waves and makes a phone call to Zork's office. Again, suspension of disbelief.
So silly.
You know, just have fun. Makes a phone call.
16-year-old wrote this. Okay, I got you.
So he answers the phone, right? And in that scene, Zork says to him, like, my costs have tripled. And the demon voice says, money is of no importance, only the stones. So I think Zork is definitely driven by... he's about to, make a really big buck on this thing, but Zork doesn't understand, though, is that when this thing comes to Earth, it's killing everybody. So in other words, he is blinded by greed and wealth, and that's a big part of why he is the epitome of what is evil in human form.
Life, which you so nobly serve, comes from destruction, disorder, and chaos. Now take this empty glass. Here it is, peaceful, serene, boring. But if it is destroyed, look at all these little things. So busy now. Notice how each one is useful. What a lovely ballet ensues, so full of form and color. Now, think about all those people that created them. Technicians, engineers, hundreds of people who will be able to feed their children tonight so those children can grow up big and strong and have little teeny-weeny children of their own and so on and so forth, thus adding to the great chain of life.
Water, fruit.
You see, Father, by creating a little destruction,
a cherry,
I'm in effect encouraging life. In reality, you and I are in the same business. Cherish.
Right.
I think what I love about it is like, that goes back to, like, the whole thing of it being a satire for me, of it being like he's so blinded he doesn't see the obvious end where he doesn't get out of this.
Right.
So he's gonna make a profit on the doomsday. It's kind of a perfect little, like, it's so over the top, but that's why it's so funny. It's because it's like, oh, look how silly this is, and then, like, it's fun to see, like, billionaires nowadays, right, who just kind of had that same kind of like lost mindedness, and they basically all became zombies.
Well, it eventually leads to his demise in the film, right? Because of his greed, and exactly, he goes and he ends up trying to get these stones at no matter what cost, and he puts himself in a position where he ends up getting himself killed.
Fitting end. Fitting end.
Speaking of wonderful like things, you already mentioned like Gary Oldman, but I love his costumes. His like evil Dr. Evil kind of like costumes are pretty great. Shane, tell us some things about the costumes you wrote things about. Can you read that?
I did.
So, keep in mind, this is French.
The costume designer. He set was up. Very French. His name was Jean-Paul Gaultier, and I'll give him this, man. He was given a very small budget. He didn't give a shit. He just went after it. And every extra has an individual outfit. There's no repeated outfits. He dressed every single person on set so that everything matched how he envisioned it. And it would take hours in the morning for him to check everybody. Like,
well, I believe so that.
So it was pretty impressive. And I guess for like Chris Tucker, because Chris Tucker showed an interview and he was like, I was not into what they were trying to do with me. And Jean-Paul Gaultier was like, what I did was I showed him the outfits that I knew that he would be like, fuck no. And then when I showed him the actual outfits, he was much happier.
Chris Tucker's character is one of the best ones in the film. He's so androgynous, and he definitely has this almost drag queen, but he still is like this manly man.
Oh, yeah. He fucks. it's so funny. So this time, I've never watched this movie with subtitles on, so I didn't understand what Chris Tucker had ever said. But this time, we had closed captions on. I was like, "Oh, this makes more sense now that I can understand."
It's not
so,
just
yeah. There's actually language, and Chris Tucker's performance is actually phenomenal, and not just him, like improvising these actual words. And you know that, like, I kept calling him Ruby Rose. You call her Roddy Piper. I couldn't remember what
Ruby
name
Rye.
It's
Ruby Rod. Yeah,
I love his character. Like at first, I thought it was like awful, but then he's grown on me. This most recent.
Oh, it's
also
so funny.
On, Mike explained to me on this go around. I watched it, and I was paying a lot more attention to little things. No one says okay; they say green.
Super like, green.
They say yeah. Like, are we green? Yeah, super
green. Oh,
green
like grass. Green like yeah, yeah. That's kind of like their new cool word.
That's weird,
I don't know
man.
What you want me to explain about that. You haven't asked a question yet.
I couldn't unsee it. I couldn't hear it. I was like, stop saying green. But
I love all the little things that world build. That's why like science fiction is like one of my favorite genres of film. Is a good director is just like this one here. Like they build like so many little worldly things that don't even be addressed. Like I love the cigarettes, for example, that always sticks with me. Were like the
huge filters on them, right?
The huge filters and the little butt at the end.
Well,
there.
So let's go back to when the film was made, the 90s, right? So cigarettes started having mm-hmm. bigger filters put on. That was actually a thing, and he almost is making fun of the fact that cigarettes are eventually going to make the point where they got these. He didn't realize vaping was going to be a thing, but you know.
Oh yeah, they all would have vaped.
Zorg should have invested in vape. Yeah, no
well, idea. I hope actually what happens in the future is vaping dies out and we go back to like it's cool to smoke real shit and people actually start smoking
real
cigarettes
plants.
Again.
Yeah.
Wait, there's a potential. Never mind. I'm just going to keep out of this one. Moving on.
Yeah, I grow my own tobacco plants at home. Oh, man. So we go through the Bruce Willis is given a ticket to Flotsam Paradise saying, go get the stones. This is all because there's an alien that has the stones and they're supposed to rendezvous at Flotsam Paradise.
Flotsam Paradise.
Flotsam. Once the ticket Subtle. Is issued, everybody in all of New York is after Corbin Dallas for their own reasons.
Even his mom.
Which leads to... Even his mom is looking for him. She's looking for Jesus Christ, Corbin.
So here's my question then. So why is it an undercover? But everyone's going to know his name, right? Because he got announced.
Well, they do play on that fact, right? So during the whole thing, Ruby Rye, like they gave him a ticket on a radio show. And the president is looking at these generals in their little war room. And they're listening. There's no like like operative kind of breakdown of them having like Secret Service. No. Like, no, they're listening to the goddamn radio show while Corbin Dallas is blowing up a cruise ship, and they're hearing all the playback from that. And the fucking generals are looking at the president, and he's like, "I wonder who taught them this." And they're like embarrassed of the fact that this is definitely not being like undercover or what's the word I'm looking for? You just used it.
Incognito.
Yeah. Incognito.
Covert, yeah.
Again, I think it's playing at the fact.
This mission in incognito mode. Sir.
Well, you got to think about like Dallas's character, right? Throughout the entire film, he's not a subtle man. He is all about just getting the job done and getting it done efficiently and quickly.
One more shot. We'll start killing hostages.
That's the leader.
Send someone to negotiate.
I've never negotiated.
You mind if I try?
No, sure. We're sending somebody in to negotiate!
Anybody else want to negotiate?
Yeah. And forcing himself on Lilu, I love it.
Oh, God. Yeah, that one, I was like, it's a little soon, Bruce. Now she does pull a gun on him, and he's like, "Oh yeah, I fucked up." But
again,
so
this was
too.
Going back to kind of what I was talking about earlier. You watch it from a perspective, right?
Yes.
I'm not going to say it's wrong, but I'm not going to say it's right.
Yeah.
You don't have to defend the ridiculous jokes.
No. Oh, I wasn't even thinking about that. I was just thinking in the movie. I was like, Jesus, man. But that's kind of starts their love story, because it's kind of like a middle school crush kind of thing, in my opinion. Because they just didn't have time.
I can see that for sure. Well, Lilu kind of presents her character as almost being a little bit, she's
childlike.
Like, underdeveloped. Like,
naive.
Like, she's,
naive.
It's almost like a computer system, right? They keep referring to her as this, like, engineered being. And then at one point, she's going through, like, the world's history, and she's doing it with, like, this insanely fast stream of just consciousness on a computer. And she's picking up on it, and she's learning it all very, very quickly. So it's like a sleeper agent computer AI system put into a flesh being is what she is. She is not fully human, but she is human at the same time.
Mike, I have a question. Are all the the servants, like the hot girls, like at McDonald's stuff, are they all androids?
No, so that is something that he did intentionally, right? So if you think about what's going to happen with actual breeding within our race, that being the human race, at some point in the future, crossbreeding will get to the point where there is ambiguous people, right? So they all were intentionally picked to be ambiguous in the sense of where their heritage is, and that is something that is, it actually is a real thing, where it is the basis of good genetics, where if you breed across the board, and you can cut this if you want, but it's intentionally made to make beautiful people in the sense that they don't have a specific underlying, like, genealogy. They all are definitely...
I gotcha.
You don't have to argue pro interracial marriage. We support.
No. But I'm saying, if I'm saying this incorrectly...
Now, hold on a goddamn second.
No, I think he did it intentionally to show that these are people that are almost more beautiful than everybody else because of the fact that they don't have bias, right? So they are interracial, and it makes them to be sexualized, and it makes them to be... And I don't think they're servants. I don't think that's the proper way to say that. They're definitely
a service industry,
but they definitely are unambiguous people.
Hostess.
Wait, so we're talking about like how they seem like they were robotic, and like... Because we're going back and forth, and like, no, she's actually responding emotionally, so it's not a robot. They're all actual people. And then there's the scene with the bar. There's actually a robot screen, like, face is serving
there's a robot bartender.
Oh, you want some warm thing? Yeah.
No, we're just like, we literally were just thinking in like the logic
we're just
of the
trying
film.
To figure out
were they actually?
Were all the hostesses and airplane stewardesses?
Flight attendants.
Were they androids?
Oh, you know, I don't know. I never thought about that, honestly.
Well, the flight attendants were because Chris Tucker fucks her.
Androids. Have you ever seen Ex Machina? I mean, you can add that feature.
Blade Runner?
I don't know, to answer that question. I don't know if they were supposed to be that or not. But I get what you're saying, though. They definitely had a trend that those people that were working the McDonald's and then who were the stewardesses on the airplane definitely looked the same. At least had the
and
same features.
And there's a scene on the cruise ship where she's, like, introducing him to his room and it's like, oh, here's your tickets. And she goes, and the show's for... And her voice changes to, like, a recording where it's like, Ruby Rod, he's so hot, I want to be with him, or something. It's so out of place. I was like, was that
No, that's just good customer service.
Oh, very good. Don't talk about me like that.
Well, work hard at the McDonald's, Shane. You'll eventually get there to the employee of the month, I promise. Okay. My most important question was, why are the Catholics the good guys? It doesn't make sense to me.
What is the question? I missed that.
No, it was stupid. I said, why are the Catholics the good
the
guys?
The Catholics? So they're actually not. If you actually look at their robes, it's actually more based on, like more Buddhist religion.
No, yeah, that makes sense. But just, like, the white guy, the old white guy, then the young priest. The old priest, young priest are just like, yeah.
Old priest and a young priest.
It made sense in the dogma that I knew. That doesn't matter. Oh, yeah, here's a question. A legitimate question, not being an asshole. So we mentioned earlier...
Wait,
like,
have you guys been being an asshole this whole time?
Oh, I have.
Oh, shit.
But,
Oh, no.
I thought I was being a part of something.
But... No, well...
You're special, Mike.
Yeah.
I love you.
I put you against the wall and firing. I legitimately was just confused about this part. So, does he like, actually love her? Or
what
is he just saying...
What kind of fucking question
the very
is that?
End, Okay, in the logic of the film. So in the very end, she says she has to hear him say, I love you, right?
Yeah. Yeah. They say, say it.
Yeah. She has to, like, actually say it, I love you, because you said that in your explanation, too. Like, she has to, like, she say it to be in love with him. Do you think Bruce actually, not Bruce, the character's name is
Corbin.
Do you think he actually loves her, or is he kind of just saying it? Or does she love her because she is the embodiment of love? I was always wondering, like, why they... Is it just, like, a fairy tale kind of logic thing, or is there actually because she's love, he truly does love her?
You know, honestly, I feel like you guys put this film under a microscope too much. I think that's the issue here. I don't know how to even answer that question. Do you believe when watching this film that he loved her?
I believe in love.
It's a film. It's
a
movie,
just, like,
right?
For...
So, in other words,
no,
in order for this whole thing to be, you want to crack down his character. Let's talk. Okay, so my personal standpoint, as far as Corbin Dallas and who he was a brutal guy who had a lot of fucked up things happen to him in his personal relationship with his ex-wife and his mother, and he hasn't been able to actually have a meaningful connection with people. So, how difficult would it have been to him to meet a woman after a couple of days to be able to say the words, I love you? So that must have been really hard for him, right? And I don't think he was the type of character to say that meaninglessly. In other words, she demanding he say that was her picking up on the sense that maybe he felt that way. Now, if that's the answer you wanted, then great. But I think that's a loaded question. You gotta be careful with that shit. This is a movie.
Yeah, fuckface. I'm like, fuck you, and I fuck her too. Yeah, fuck you, Ronnie.
Apologies.
I don't know. I'm not him. It's a fun film.
It is like a it's like a comic book, basically, where there's plot holes and stuff, but it's about enjoying what you're seeing and hearing and keeping going forward.
Now, if you have a problem with love, then that's a different conversation. We can do that off the podcast.
Yeah, we could talk this in the streets.
Streets? I thought maybe like a therapist session.
Oh. In the streets. All right, so we get to Flotsam Paradise after a bunch of shenanigans. We get introduced to Ruby Rod, and it starts out with Ruby Rod, yeah, and they go to the opera because that's where he's going to meet his contact. And they have the most famous part of The Fifth Element, which is the opera action scene. This is pretty well done. Some legit explosions took place in this. And Bruce Willis obviously gets to show off his diehard ways in kind of like a funny, quirky way. And I loved it. I have a little couple facts about the opera, but let's talk about it first.
Sure.
This is like the only scene that doesn't work for me. rest of the movie works.
You're fucking high, man.
No, this is the only one. I think everything else, but this is the one that for me is like, this is like too goofy and Die Hardy. The rest of it works for me, like the silliness, but this is the one. I know this is your favorite scene, Shane, so that's why.
It is.
I'm bringing it up. This is the only one that doesn't work for me. I get the rest of it. It's fun. This one is so silly. It's so silly.
It is very, it is silly. Very silly.
Yeah.
The opera, then like the ending of it's like hip-hoppy, and she looks like a awesome Star Wars character, and then she's doing the kung fu, super 90s, like even pre-Matrix, like kung fu, taking that shit from overseas, like kind of karate, like films like that there, like, and then on top of that, Gary Oldman's going there with this just silly ways, and his big old gun, it's just, oh my gosh, it's so funny, it's so much.
This might be one of the scenes in the film. The reason that I probably don't look at it the way you're looking at it, because I definitely get where you're coming from. But maybe my little adolescent original viewing of the film ingrained it in my head enough that as an adult, it's not coming across as so silly. But I get what you're saying. It is, at its core, kind of weird.
The Lilu fight's a little corny.
It's fun,
but
though.
I do like the opera and how everything is played over it, you know, to add kind of dramatic flair. And the opera singer that did it is really, really good, I guess. Like, the composer wrote the opera, and he said it had to sound like something a human couldn't perform. So he's like, I literally put things in there that a human shouldn't be able to do. And he's like, I actually only had to edit a few things because she kept hitting the things that he thought a human couldn't do.
Really?
Yeah. He was like, Jesus.
This might be a little bit of a side note. Did you see that? So, yeah, there was a little bit of auto-tuning and definitely some
They had to.
Adjustments to it. But there is a, it was a couple years ago. There was an actual opera singer. I think she was from China or Japan. I don't remember. But she got real close, like without auto-tuning. It's very impressive.
Dang. Yeah, I think it's something like she, in like one verse or whatever the fuck, it's like 9 octaves or something. It's like a lot. It's insane. It's supposed to be impossible. But I like the scene a lot, but I love the action, and I think this is the best action, especially with the Mangalores and their goofy Muppetry.
And the whole last...
He basically... Yeah. Like, bonks and boinks his way through all of them.
The last 20 minutes of the film are just pure, unadulterated 90s action.
And Ruby Rod's scream. Oh my god, I giggle every time. That's his line for the rest of the film, is screaming.
It is a good conclusion to the film, right? This one doesn't leave you... A lot of films, they kind of lose me at the very end of them. This one kind of carries through till the end, right? It has some slow parts, it's got some up parts, and then there's just in-your-face action until we get to a conclusion, and then it's over, and it doesn't drag it out.
Oh, yeah, the James Bond ending.
Exactly, yeah.
Yes,
sex in a tube.
Yep.
No, but, like, I think that's what, like, looking at this movie, because, like, I've been joking and kind of, like, poking you, Mike, to get you to come at me, but...
Oh, that's okay. Don't worry, I'm picking up.
No, but I, like, legitimately enjoy, like, I think that last scene sells it for me in this most recent viewing of like, oh, this is a James Bond movie. It doesn't matter, like, all my nitpicky bullshit questions just to kind of rile you up, like, just to see what you can, like, how would you defend this movie? Like, I don't think that shit matters because it's just a fucking fun ride. It's just a silly space movie with, like, a vision, and I think he gets the unadulterated version, like, a vision here of this movie of just, like, nonsense and silly fun. And like I said, I think the only scene that doesn't work for me is just the opera. I think it's too many stuff, but I love all the ending. And I like it's the little message of, like, the fifth element's love. It's always love. It's the answer to the space movies. The universe is empty, so love the one you're with.
Good. No, I'm right on board with you, man.
Yeah. So
my last question for Mike.
Yeah.
If you want to ask him, Shane, so you feel important again.
I don't.
The whole podcast is just me... asking Mike questions to make a man of Shane sitting there giggling, you know, himself.
I'm just realizing now that we're over an hour into this, and now I'm catching on that this was an assault on me. I walked into a goddamn trap.
It's a trap.
You know what? It's a trap. What I respect is Mike complete sincerity, you defended the fucking shit out of this. You should have been a lawyer for Trump. You would have got him out of there if you were the lawyer for Trump, because you were like, I'm not going to back down from the silliest thing I've ever seen in my entire life.
Are there mountains of evidence that point that my client should go to prison? Yes. Did he share state secrets openly and have it recorded? Yes. But Corbin Dallas.
But it was fun, right?
Corbin Dallas won the medal.
But we had a good 4 years. It was entertaining, at least.
Right?
All
right,
what's the
search last... your feelings. You know it to be true. All
right, what's the last question?
My last question is, what would be one thing you change about the film? Is there? I know it's a near-perfect movie to you, right? I don't think you really talked about it. You've seen this how many times, approximately?
Oh, I don't even know. I don't even know. At one point, I watched it every week for a month, and at one point, I watched it once a month for a year. So
that's you've seen it like 100 goddamn times.
A lot, yeah. I have it. Okay, I actually have tattoos of it.
That's why you're invited on this.
I've actually paid people to imprint ink into my skin to show people I like this movie.
And he is the Fifth Element.
It's actually a test of people, because like sometimes people are like, do you have the fucking Fifth Element tattooed on you? I'm like, sure do.
And you just passed the
mic. We're now best friends.
High five.
Strap in. I'm about to tell you some shit.
Let's talk about the movie. Okay. So my last question is, is there anything you change about the film? One thing you change to make it a little more perfect?
Well, I got to think about that for a second.
I don't know if I want it changed. Because if it changes, then it means it's a little better. And if it's a little better, then I don't look past some things. It sits right in that perfect spot where it just...
Honestly, nice. So every single time I've seen this, and it has been a lot of times, I actually still do pick up on things that I missed beforehand, so I don't think that there is something yet I would like to change about it, because I don't think I have fully actually understood the film.
Yeah. I might want Lilu to be a little more grown up towards the end, like an accelerated maturity, in a way. Not much more, because I get she's childlike in her naive ways and stuff, but like, she still feels too childlike at the end for me, but that would be the only slight change.
This is my response to that. In all honesty, it has its faults, but I think that makes it charming, and I like the fact that it has its faults. So no, I don't think it needs to be changed. I think it was done properly. I think the director needs to stop making films.
Just stop, Luke. Just stop.
He should have stopped after this one.
Yeah. Yeah, really. This was the last one that he made that was, well, Taken was kind of a hit.
I've never gone back and watched Taken multiple times.
No, they're not. But I could see how they put food on his fat table for a while. Because he's fat.
Is he?
I didn't mind.
Is he a big boy?
Oh, yeah. He's a fat boy.
No.
I didn't mind Lucy. Like, I didn't think it was great.
Oh,
but
yeah, he made Lucy, too.
I didn't mind Lucy. Lucy was fine. Like, I don't think it was, like, insulting. It wasn't like, I don't think I told you, but my wife and I saw Valerian. We walked out. my wife is
like, I don't blame you.
My wife is not, like, a big sci-fi person, but she likes enough sci-fi. But 20 minutes in, when, like, the beginning was happening with the alien they're chasing, she looks at me and goes, I hate this. Can we leave? So I never figured out what had happened in that fucking movie.
You know, this is strange, as you know, as far as this goes, like, it's, you know, obviously I've now shown your viewers, or your listeners, that I am deeply in love with this film, but I hate the director. I think he's garbage, and I don't like his other films.
I like Leon, and that's about the only one that I can point to. I'm like, yeah, I like Leon the Professional a lot.
You want to talk about creepy chauvinism, Leon is that.
Yeah, it's a little scary. It hit me out with the 9-year-old. Or
I've still never seen it.
With Natalie Portman.
God, I really want to figure out a thing that I have to say. I don't want to just leave this as I love it so much it's perfect, because I do want to actually give it a critique. So,
the only thing, I'm not a big fan of the opera scene, but whatever. I think it's the style of the film. I like the idea, and I don't want to increase the length of this movie, but the idea that when Lilu finally sees like the war and figures out the human race is, you know, kind of shitty, but I'm sure all alien histories probably have, you know, a period of, like, darkness, a long period of darkness. But point being is, like, I wish they'd, like, developed that a little bit more, because that was a cool idea, like, she's naive, and then she's learning what you know, the atrocities of the world, because the world is not just so simple as black and white. There's like that gray kind of area there. So I like that, but I think that was too real for like the film.
Well, I think the Wanda Chiwin, if you look at their characters, I think they're like a race of pussies, right? So like they they didn't have defensive any guns true. On their ship. Very they true. Just got fucking railed into a planet like, when they what? Got shot down. So I think
oh, no.
they're the type of guys who are like, I think they were so peaceful to a fault that they needed to use humans who have war to develop their love weapon. Like, you know what I mean? Like, if you actually go back and deep dive into the Wanda Chiwin, they made a love weapon. That's silly as fuck. Like, they were so weapon? Lovely. They're like the Teletubbies of space. And they made this, like...
That's what I told my wife the other night. I got a love weapon for you. Stick them up.
Yeah, they developed the love beam. Like, that was their... They did Heart. You know, like, in Captain Planet. Who the fuck is that guy? Yeah. Heart? That's what the Fifth Element is.
Captain Planet stole his shit from this.
It was a Care Bear.
Oh. I do like the little puzzle at the end, how they open the stones. Like, they figure out you blow on wind, you sweat on water, and then they have the scene with the one match, which I'm like, oh, come on, that thing would have broke. You know
it. I like that the scene of that is... So, like, I'm going to lay it out there. I used to be a smoker. And, like, seeing the fact that, like, everybody's trying to give up smoking and then they needed a match. The smoking went, like, won. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I should start smoking again. We're all in agreement.
Yeah, this is a pro-smoking podcast for
Thank
sure.
Thank God.
Especially for
podcast
kids.
In no way endorses underage smoking. But if you're above the age of whatever illegal within your state, please smoke away. We're sponsored by Marlboro.
And you will save the world.
It'd be a lot cooler if you did.
Oh my god.
So we save the planet, have sex in the tube with the funny ending, and then we got the Fifth Element. It was a huge success.
Huge.
I don't know how much money it made, but it was made for $60 million, so
I believe it was over
like 50,
I believe it was over $200 million.
Yeah.
It was $250 million, I think, something like that.
Yeah. So Luc Besson did very well and then just kinda didn't carry the same thing forward. It sounds like any product of love. It was a nightmare to make. Get the fuck out of here, guy. Like, just from the special effects and everything, I think he was pretty burnt out from it. Like, I think other than Valerian, I don't think he really did any special effects heavy thing after.
Lucy,
maybe. But I think he just shot everything he had into this movie and then couldn't do it anymore.
I wouldn't say it has, like, a cult following, but it has, like, legit, like, followers. Obviously, like, like Mike here, but, like, when I resaw it in theaters, like, a year ago, and people, like, were wearing the shirts, so, like, there's, like, I wouldn't say cult, because it's not like it's a not-heard-of movie,
that's
right?
It's just above cult.
Yeah, because, like, I remember seeing it on TNT, too, as a kid, so, like, it's not, like, a hidden, like, gem there. It's popular, so that's why we wanted to talk about it, was just, like, this is such a unique film, like, this tone and just, like... The singular, silly vision. It's a lot of fun.
I 100% agree. Yeah, I actually, there was a couple of years ago before the pandemic that my birthday present, my wife actually surprised me and they were playing it at some, you know, little avant-garde Seattle movie theater and the Fifth Element was playing. And we actually went and saw it again in theaters and holy shit, it was so good to see it on the big screen again.
That's fun. I like that.
What a positive note
well,
to end on, Shane.
That's it. That's love. That's the Fifth Element. And, you know, there's tons of things we talked about in the back of it, but I think we all love the Fifth Element. That's why it's a glass half full.
Well,
and we wanted Mike because no one loves the Fifth Element like Mike does.
Well, I hope, Ronnie, I was able to at least open your eyes a little bit and maybe give it a second chance, or I think you said it's been three times, maybe a fourth chance, but...
His heart grew three sizes that
day. No, wait. I was doing a goddamn bit. You said antagonize Mike. I was going for Mike. I just have questions that are just asshole questions I didn't even ask you. I have so many more.
Mike, just want to ask you, why is this movie suck? If you could just tell me why this movie sucks.
And you know
so
what?
Hard.
I can give you a positive answer why this movie is terrible.
Yep. And that's why Mike would like to announce his running for the 2024
Well, I appreciate it. This has been a great podcast. Thank you for inviting me. I was really happy to talk about my favorite movie of all time, and I hope that I was able to sway you guys a little bit toward the positive version of what The Fifth Element is.
I am. I'm swayed. What about you, Ronnie? Are you swayed?
Please follow us on Instagram, on Twitter. Please subscribe, like to YouTube, to things like that. Mike, do you have anything out there? Do you guys still do the podcast you do?
Well, the working title is a little bit of a slug right now, but there's nothing really else going on. Yeah, I think watching movies is what I'm doing now.
Just getting high living
Full time.
Want to join the podcast? You see more on the ball than shitting here.
I am sorry. I got too high. I am so fucking high.
Where were you?
God help America. Thank you, Mike. Lovely to talk to you as always.
I appreciate it. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, thanks for your time. Appreciate it. Check out Working Title. There's three wonderful podcasters on there, and then also Shane, and they talk about films, and then Shane just ruins it by interjecting himself into it.
Yeah. Maybe one day we'll do a commentary on Valerian with Mike.
Oh, God, I would love that. You want to hear me shit on a film? That's the one.
We'll schedule it. Ronnie, take us home. I can't.
Give me a good quote from the film there, Mike.
Oh, shit. Good quote from the film. Like an outro quote?
Yeah. Yeah, give us a... You said, like, you know that, like, you know so many
quotes. Got it.
Give us a good one.
That's the best goddamn show I've ever done.
Yes!
Disappointing.
What? That's not disappointing?
I am very disappointed. I like it, Mike. Well... Folks, that's all we got. Go watch The Fifth Element over and over and over and over again and let it change your life.
And watch The Stone. You'll have a better time.
Join the Church of the Manishawan today.
Montachiwin.
I don't remember their fucking names.
Montachiwin.
See, we just watched this movie. I don't remember their names, the armadillo people. Chikachawa?
What'd you call
it? Chupachabras.
Oh, we didn't even talk about how this, like, basically George Lucas stole this film for Phantom Menace.
Oh, yeah. The Phantom Menace is like a direct steal.
Jar Jar Binks.
Yep, Ruby Rod.
You have like the
Coruscant.
The dated 90s visual of Coruscant.
Oh, now you guys are just trying to piss me off.
Damn, George Lucas.
And we're out.
All right, stop your recording.
Mr. President. Let me introduce you to Professor McTilbury, who runs the center.
It's an honor to receive you, Mr. President.
Yes. Where are my two heroes?
Oh, they were so tired from their ordeal, we put them in the reactor this morning.
I have 19 more meetings after this one, Professor.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Let me see if they're revived.
Thank you.
We go live in 1 minute, Mr. President.
Mm-hmm.
They're
fucking...
Not ready. They need 5 more minutes.
You have 20 seconds.
No, ma'am. No, I tried. No, ma'am.
Who's that?
Some woman claims to be Corbin's mother.
Well, give it here. Mrs. Dallas, this is the president. On behalf of the Federation, I would like to...
You're not the damn president. I know you're not the president. Don't let Michael fool you. He's bullshitting the whole time. He's a big dorky. He loves the Fifth Element. Ronnie's just being a dickhead. Shane was too high. The podcast sucked. Just turn it off. Just turn it off now. You're not the president. The president's big and strong. He's not my president.
Time for a halftime conversation here in the locker room. You need to get your shit together right now. You need to man the fuck up.
No.
It's only marijuana. It's not like it's Molly. You're fine. You need to man the fuck up. Take hold. Take the reins of this podcast back, Shane.
Okay.
Taking America back right now.
All right.
Taking America back right now.
Fill me, Joe Rogan. Fill me with your spirit.
Inspirational words.
I've taken the athletic greens.
It's shot to the dome.
You were recording this. Oh, no.
I was recording this. I'm saving this one for the end. And okay, Caboose ready.